Hi, everyone. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. We have a great session. So I'm not going to spend too much time talking since I'm not the expert here, but I will pass it on to our fabulous speaker today. And thank you all so much again for joining us today.
Hi, everyone. Welcome, Denise and the On Deck team. Thank you so much for having me. Also great to see some familiar faces in the audience. Thank you for turning up today. I'm Bettina Grab. I'm the partner and president at Alder & Co. We are a marketing agency focused exclusively on scaling climate tech companies. And this is what today's talk is about as well. So I'm going to share my screen. Let me figure that out. All right. Can you all see my screen? Yeah, okay, perfect. Thank you. So topic today is from brand to scale, growth marketing for climate tech. And we have an hour, and I think only part of this is going to be the presentation. So it's going to be a real quick high-level overview of how we work with climate tech startups to scale them. So if you are a marketing expert and you've scaled 10 startups before, then this might be too high level for you, or you might already know all of this. But if you are a founder or a salesperson or business development person who is wearing the marketing hat, or you are a marketer who maybe was at a large organization and is looking to pivot into climate tech, and you want to know, you know, how you will, as a generalist, now scale a climate tech company, then this session is probably more for you. So it's really about, what do I need to do from a marketing perspective, depending on the stage my company is in as you scale. And the structure for today is, hang on, I need to move my Zoom thingy out of the way. There you go. So quick introduction, then I'm going to use the framework of the four climate tech valleys of death, which was developed by the Rocky Mountain Institute as the framework to guide us through the presentation. I'm just going to quickly talk about what each valley means from a marketing perspective. And then at the end, I have some examples as well to show you how that might look like. And now I can't flip to the next slide. Why not? Oh, there you go. Okay, quick introductions. As I said, I'm Bettina. I work for Alder & Co. We're a climate tech marketing agency working with climate tech companies and helping them to scale. And we have a methodology that we call from brand to scale. My background is actually corporate B2B marketing. So I worked for a large global organization most of my career out of London, doing deep tech B2B marketing for North America, UK, Ireland, and Southeast Asia. I'm also a guest lecturer for climate tech marketing at the Presidio Graduate School here in the Bay Area. I volunteer as the national marketing chair for Cleantech Open, which is the largest cleantech accelerator here in the US. You might be able to tell by my accent that I'm originally from Germany. I'm married to a Brit, was living in the UK, as I mentioned, and I'm normally based in Fremont in the Bay Area. And I'd love to be in the chat. Some of you have already gone ahead and put in who you are and where you dial in from. Maybe put your name, where you're based, and also maybe what your marketing background is or your level of knowledge. It really helps me to pitch you know, my presentation and what I tell you. So please feel free to put stuff in the chat. When I'm not doing marketing for climate tech, I'm really passionate about zero waste and reducing the plastic waste we produce in our daily lives as consumers. And I used to write a blog about it. You can go and check it out, but I haven't written anything for 2 years because I'm now focused on scaling my business, which is older. I also love baking, mainly German sourdough breads. I'm a yogi. I run, and in the winter, I snowboard. So, as I mentioned, the four valleys of death that any climate tech startup will face. So I guess these valleys of death are similar for any startup, but they're just a little bit more tricky for climate tech companies, just because climate tech is typically very technical, you know, deeply scientific, it's often hardware focused. So it's just that little bit more difficult to scale than, say, you know, your typical software SaaS company. So I'm just going to quickly run through those valleys of death, what they are, and maybe you recognize some of them based on your experience. So the first valley of death is, you know, taking the technology or whatever your climate tech innovation is out of the lab or out of your head or off from paper and into the market. So this is when you form your company. So the startup formation is really the first valley of death. And that is, how do you get from an idea to an actual company? So it's about, you know, naming the company, forming a brand, and actually forming a company. And that's likely when you go from being the solo founder to having a founding team, either finding some co-founders or finding your first two or three employees that help you get this thing off the ground. The second valley of death is where you're developing your product or your solution, and it's where you have to prove to the market that there is actually a product market fit. That's usually required to get funding. So obviously people need to understand that you're onto something and there's really a market. The third valley of death is then proving that solution or the product, so getting market validation. It's getting your first pilot, paid pilot, and proving that there is demand in the market for what you're doing. And then the fourth valley of death is really getting from that first pilot to a repeatable system for lead generation and getting your first 10 customers or your first 100 customers. And that's where you really scale. Does anyone recognize these valleys of death? Have you come across them? Have you experienced them in your career? Feel free to put it in the chat. Okay. So now we're going to talk about which role does marketing play and how can marketing help a climate tech company overcome those valleys of death so that you don't die a slow death. So the first one, as I said, is when you're, you know, it's about the startup formation, founding the company. And that's really where the brand comes in. And it's funny because we talk to a lot of early stage climate tech companies and they're always like, yeah, we know brand is important, but we're not there yet. You know, we'll do that later. We need to develop our product first. We need to get the company off the ground first. Well, the brand is really the one thing that helps you do that, because at that point in time, you have nothing other than maybe an idea or a technology in the lab or something on paper. So why would other people come and join you? Well, they join you because they believe in you. And how do you express your belief? It's through the brand. The brand is the values that you put around the company you're going to create. It's your vision, you know, where are you heading? What are you trying to achieve? And your mission, what is it that drives you? The brand is the gut feeling that people get when they meet you and why they start believing in you. And that's why they start joining you. So even if your logo isn't perfect or your website isn't perfect, it's really critical to have your brand mapped out right at the beginning, because it'll set you up for success. It might evolve over time, but you definitely need something to start off with. Second value of death. So this is where you're going to prove product market fit or develop your first minimum viable product. And if you've gone through a number of accelerators or incubators, you know, they will tell you the most important thing at this stage is that you do customer discovery. And I would totally agree. You know, you need that customer feedback to know what features to develop or to really even understand the needs and the problems that you're solving for your potential customers. Now, what we say as marketers is, yes, go out and interview at least 100 potential customers to get information, but also use the time as a listening exercise. Don't just ask them questions. Also give them like a high level overview of what you're trying to achieve and then just ask them, is that clear? You know, does that make sense to you? Do you understand what we're trying to do? And then solicit some questions in return, because those are really valuable, because people will go like, yeah, but I don't really know, like, at what part of the business that would help me with, or I don't really understand how that would make my company more productive, or how it would reduce costs for us, or it wouldn't, you know, I don't really understand how that would solve problem X. So those questions that you're getting in return during your customer discovery are really gold, and we'll see why that is, because they inform, you know, what your potential customers are thinking when they meet you for the first time. And this is how you would want to structure your marketing and your content further down the line. So keep track of all those questions you're getting in those early stages. Also from investors and from other, you know, any stakeholder you meet, whatever they're asking you about what you're trying to do, keep track of those questions. And then once you've done that, you move over to, you know, articulating your solution or your product. And there we often see that people, you know, founders often just focus on the solution or on the product or on the technology. But it's very likely that you're developing something that is completely innovative, that doesn't exist before. So you're actually even creating a problem that people might not even be aware of, that they have that problem. So, you know, try and spend some time articulating the actual problem that you're solving and why that creates a pain for the customer. Because only a problem that's creating a pain is something worth solving for. So, you know, try and consider the whole triangle of problem, how that's causing a pain, how your solution solves it, and then how can it be actionable? So also try and communicate, okay, I have this solution. How can my customers deploy that solution? How will it actually, you know, work and resolve the problem and the pain? That's valley number two. Valley number three is, you know, you've done your product or technology development, and now you're at that stage where you've secured your first pilot. Amazing. Congratulations. You found a big company that's actually willing to work with you and test your product or technology. That's an awesome achievement already. And now, you know, you do this pilot, and this is going to become your first case study. This is what's going to set you up for future success, because the case study is so valuable, because other companies that are like that company that you're working with on your pilot, that's how they recognize themselves in your customer. They will ask the same question. You know, they're like, okay, I'm a utility, and this other utility is already working with us. So there's got to be something in it. And then, you know, you tell them, why did that pilot company choose to work with you? How did you do the pilot? What did you learn together? How did you overcome challenges? You know, both from a product perspective, but also from a relationship perspective. So really mine that pilot for content, and then, you know, create your first case study. I've brought an example here for a company called 75F. They're in the building optimization space. You might know them. They're way past startup stage, but they do a really great job with case studies. So go and check them out on their website. And then, you know, that becomes a great story to tell to journalists, to investors. You can put it on your website. You can turn it into two pages that you take to events. So really nail that case study at that stage of company development. And now you're at the fourth valley of death. This is where you're trying to get from that first or second or third pilot to really scaling it and earning money and getting revenue in and repeating that 10 times, 50 times, 100 times over with companies. So this is where you're in the demand generation stage, where marketing really kicks in. You know, you really want to raise your profile, you want to tell the stories of your pilot customers, and you want to win more customers like them. So this is where you get into the actual growth marketing mechanisms. And I'm going to spend a little bit more time here, because this is, you know, where we're really, where the work begins and where we do most of the work with our clients. And at that stage, what typically happens is complete overwhelm from a marketing perspective, because the startup knows, okay, we have proof, we have pilots, people are paying us money for this. How do we get the word out and where do we start? Do we just go on social media or do we go to a bunch of events? How do you prioritize? So this is where we typically recommend to be strategic and thoughtful and follow a process. And this is also our brand to scale process. So first, the reason that's important, so I put a little fact here that, you know, even if you're in B2B, which most likely you are if you're in climate tech, companies or your potential customers will go and check you out online before they actually talk to you. So they will go to your website, they will see if you've been mentioned in the media, they might see if they can meet you at events. So you want to be where they are online to make it easier for your sales team to sell. So the first step in the scaling framework is to develop your customer persona. And this goes a little bit deeper than just doing customer discovery, because you're now going into the organizations that you're trying to sell to, and you're trying to figure out who's actually making the decision, like who's in the end going to write off the check to work with you, and then who's influencing that decision. And in B2B, you know, you're likely going to meet 1 to 3 personas, sometimes 5. But it's usually, you know, it's usually the user who's actually going to use your product. But then there's other people influencing that. So it might be the chief sustainability officer who has a mandate to make sure that their organization is becoming more sustainable. Or it might obviously be the CFO who, you know, oversees the budget. Or it might be the purchasing department who makes sure that it's risk-free, or, you know, to minimize the risk of working with a startup. So they will do some checks on you to say, hey, is this company credible? They, you know, are they even going to be around in 3 years' time? So you really want to understand who the people are who are making the decision. And you can either go back to your customer discovery material and see if you can mine it from what you found out then, or you're just doing another round of interviews with your existing customers and actually ask them retrospectively, hey, you know, when you decided to work with us, who was actually involved and why and what did they do? And I've put a few bullets here, the things that you should check off to develop your full persona. So as I said, what's the role in the organization? What's their title so that you can find them on LinkedIn, to market to them in the future? What are their goals? And that's both for their company, but also personally. You know, are they looking to advance in their career? Is this going to be risky if they put their head out to work with you? You know, are they putting their head on the line because it's a risky decision to work with an early stage startup? What are their pain points that you're solving? How or why would they reject working with you? So you want to go through those bullets and make sure you have answers to all of that. And then you create a neat little profile of who you are actually. This is the first step. This then also informs the customer journey. So how are they moving through the sales funnel as they engage with you? And you want to understand what questions they are asking either you or themselves in their head as they move through that journey. And I'm sure you've seen this concept before. It's sometimes called slightly different things. I think it's sometimes called discovery or awareness, consideration, decision stage. I like to call it discover, consider, justify, and I'll tell you why in a minute, but it doesn't really matter. Basically, it's the typical sales funnel. And at the top, you know, it's the discovery stage. And this is something that's also often overlooked by startups because they always quickly jump to themselves and their company and talking about their own solution and what they're doing and the technology. But at the discover stage, you're obviously not even known to whoever you're trying to sell to. And they might not even understand their own problem properly, or they might not understand that they need to go and search for a solution. So this is all about helping them educate themselves about the problem that they're experiencing. So you're creating the problem, you're creating the need or the feeling to go and do something about it. So you're trying to answer questions like, okay, what is it that I don't really know? Or what is actually my problem? What's causing this problem? Or why is it going to become a problem in the future? And is there anyone else facing that problem? And this will inform the content in the next stage. In the consider stage, this is when, you know, they've understood their problem and they're starting to look for a solution. So this is where you have to try and get into that list of solutions that they're considering. So you give them a list of how they could solve their problem. You could also give them, you know, an overview of the market. This is where descriptions about the product come into play. How does my technology work? What are the benefits? You know, features, benefits, all that good stuff. Also maybe a price or cost comparison. So startups typically have this thing figured out pretty well because it's all you're dealing with all the time, so not a big deal. The next one, however, is the one that's really crucial. It's the one that's going to get the deal over the line. So it's the justify part. And why do I call it justify? Oops, sorry. Well, it's because, you know, the likely scenario is that you're a tiny startup and your customer is a huge organization, a utility or an industrial conglomerate, a manufacturing company, whatever, a car manufacturer. So why should they work with you? So it's all about justifying and de-risking the decision to work with you. So you need to prove credibility and experience and stability to them. So in that stage, you know, what they're asking themselves is, you know, who are these guys? Has anyone actually worked with them? Also, you know, convincing the finance people, what's the ROI? Can I try it out? But it's also like, who's invested in them? Or have they got any accreditations, any certifications for their technology? Have they been featured in really respected industry media? So everything that signifies credibility. Have they won some awards? So those are the kind of questions you want to answer in the justify stage. And then once you have your personas and the questions they're asking, then you can do a content audit. So you check your own website, you check your materials that you've already created, and you check, okay, am I actually answering those questions that my personas are asking? And if not, how can we answer them in a really easy way and make them accessible on different channels? And then if you're really thinking about lead generation, so trying to get contact details of people that you want to sell to, then you also want to make sure that content is gated. So that is, you know, if you have an in-depth white paper or a how-to guide, something that's really valuable that people are willing to trade their contact details for. So you might want to create one of those and put them on your website in a prominent way so that people see that pop up and they go, oh yes, you know, the top 10 ways to solve problem X. Oh, that's really useful. I'd love to have that guide. You know, it doesn't actually talk about your company or your product. It just helps them with what they're trying to achieve. So you check, you know, do I have that content and is it easy to find on my channel? Then is it easily accessible? And if not, you know, what are the gaps and how should I fill the gaps as a priority? And that's how you start your content roadmap. So, you know, what should we create next? Blog posts, videos, infographics, whatever it may be. So eventually when you put it all together, you know, this is in an abstract way how it might look like. You know, you have the discover stage, you have a persona, it's a CXO that has a problem. They go off searching online, they might Google something, and then they might come across an article that your founder has written in the media. It really helps them understand the problem. They go to your website, they find your white paper, they download it. Okay, now you have a lead. You can contact them because you have your contact details. So you move into the consider stage, you might invite them to an event that you're speaking at, or you might host your own webinar and invite them to it. You track how they're engaging with your content because now you have your contact details. And then, you know, that's when sales starts engaging. You might have a sales conversation with them. And you know, okay, hey, we're actually on their shortlist. We might win this guy, this deal. And then it's all about supplying them with justified content. So prove that you're, you know, you're well established, that you know your stuff, that other companies trust you, that you have reputable investors, everything to get the deal over the line. So I know this was abstract, so I brought an example from my past. It's not climate tech, but it's deep, you know, B2B tech stuff. And this is a campaign we did that won us an award, just to show kind of how you move your contact through the funnel. So it was a company that worked with public sector workers and offered automation for public sector processes, you know, document processing, that kind of stuff. So first we did a survey inviting public sector work, you know, administrative staff to answer questions about their problem. So it wasn't even about the solution. You're like, okay, what are you most struggling with in your day-to-day work? Those kind of questions. We worked with an industry partner, you know, a research institute to disseminate that survey. And then we got about, I don't know, 2,000 responses or 1,000 responses, which is great. That gave us a lot of great content. So we were, A, first able to produce a report from the survey that we sent back to the people who had responded to the survey. So that was our first touch point. It also gave us really great data to do a press release to say, hey, this is what public sector people are struggling with. These are the top 10 challenges. That got us into the media. Then we took all that content and went a bit more in depth and actually added our own insights and saying, okay, how can you drive transformation in the public sector through automation? Again, we sent that back out to the people who completed the survey, but it was also on our website, and we offered it to the media, and we promoted it through social media and paid advertising. So that got us a load of new leads, people who really wanted this white paper because it helped them with this, with their problem. We also did some paid media sponsorships. We did a video about everything we found out, like a little explainer video. And we also did a roundtable event with experts who spoke about the whole topic. And we invited everyone who had previously engaged in the whole campaign. So I don't know, 50 people turned up to the event. It was a really successful campaign because we got a lot of new leads. Because there was so much content that we had to engage with to keep sending to the leads, you know, we could track who's looking at what, who's downloading what, and we could see that there were about 10 companies who, or public sector organizations who were really highly engaged. So the sales team knew, okay, if we reach out to those 10 organizations, we're going to have a really informed conversation because we already know what they looked at. We know that they're interested. That's what happened. And then we actually won, you know, 2 deals out of this whole campaign, which is great for a marketer because you can prove that what you're doing is actually working. Ideal case scenario, I completely understand that this might be too advanced for a startup stage, but just showing you how this whole process can work in practice. So I know that was a lot to run through in a really short amount of time, but as a recap, you're starting out as a company. First valley of death, what's really important is your brand. Make sure you're clear about your vision, your mission, your values. Second valley of death is when you're working on your technology. Really use customer discovery to inform your content roadmap and understand what people are actually asking you about. Third valley of death, market validation. Really milk that case study and use it for storytelling. And then fourth valley of death, when it comes to scaling, follow that framework I just presented. Make sure you get your personas right. Understand what they're asking you and themselves in their head. Create content to answer those questions and think about which channels you can use to get that content to those people. And that will start kicking off your demand generation machine. All right. Thank you. That was the presentation. If your head is spinning or you think, okay, this is all great, but I can't afford a company like Alder to run our marketing, that's totally fine. That's why we've created Tofu, which is a community for marketers or people who wear the marketing hat at climate tech companies. And it's a bi-weekly newsletter, and it is a Slack group with around 400 people in it, all marketing experts, and it's amazing for getting tips, tricks, you know, events that are going on. Ask any question and the community will come to your rescue and help out. So I invite everyone to join, and I'm going to put the link in the chat in a minute. And then these are just some of the companies we work with at Alder. Actually, one of the prior OnDeck, I know this was originally associated with OnDeck, this talk, and one of the OnDeck alumni is one of our clients, and that was great to work with them. And here are my contact details, which I'm also going to put in the chat afterwards. I'm going to stop sharing now, and I hope we can move on to Q&A. Okay. Everyone's like,
we did have a question in the chat, so I can read it out. But yeah, they're, oh, great, Laura.
Yeah, go ahead.
Great to meet you, and just huge thanks. That was super informative and practical. I love that there was a case study about the process. So just huge thanks for outlining that. I think I'm curious, like, how the typical client you work with, and like where you typically jump in the process, and maybe like what some of the biggest challenges are.
Yeah, great question. Thank you, Laura. So we typically, you know, come in at the growth stage. So Valley Forth, when you really, you know, they've proven market traction, they have customers in place, they have funding. But our, you know, our methodology is from brand to scale. So what we often find that even though we're being brought in to help with the scaling piece, that the brand piece isn't quite complete. So they're either not clear on, you know, their positioning and messaging. They haven't really clearly articulated their vision and mission and values. Or frankly, you know, the visual brand isn't quite right. So maybe they, you know, took a clip art that was blue and green when they started, and then they didn't pay any attention to the brand until they got to that stage. But now we know if the brand is not complete, the whole scaling piece doesn't work. So we often then go back and do like a rebranding project or a positioning and messaging exercise or a marketing strategy exercise to make sure we have that roadmap, you know, figured out, and that framework that I just went through with the personas and the content and the gaps. And then we start executing and creating the content and running campaigns. So we're very strategic. You know, we always do the strategy and try and understand the business goals of our clients before we start.
Cool, thanks.
Okay, maybe I can ask the audience, does anyone recognize themselves in the valleys of death, or do you have any examples where you've experienced some of these challenges? Or any other questions?
There was a question in the chat that I can read out loud super quick, but it says, convincing early stage businesses of this value, number one, is hard at the beginning. What are some of the ways we can better explain on the value?
Do you mean the value of marketing or value of having values in place? Sorry, let me read the... Okay. Yeah. Well, I think the thing is, you know, once people start working on their brand, and I'm not necessarily just talking about the visual identity, I really mean like being clear on your vision and your mission and your values, it kind of proves the value itself, because all of a sudden they will find it a lot easier to attract, you know, new team members or investors, or, you know, have conversations with stakeholders. So I think it's kind of learning by doing, and kind of proves itself once you start working on your brand, is my experience. And I think, you know, there's also data that really supports this. If you look at comparisons, you know, for example, if you look at exit scenarios, companies that IPO or, you know, sell their company in a strategic merger or something, the ones who have a really reputable brand achieve a higher price, you know, and there's data supporting that. So, I mean, all founders are working towards an exit eventually. And if you want to make sure it pays off for all the hard work, you really want to start about building a strong brand right from the beginning. It'll just make your life easier. But yeah, I understand it's a tough discussion to have, especially in climate tech, where, you know, a lot of founders are amazing scientists and engineers, and maybe marketing isn't as close to their heart as it is for us. But, you know, just be open, listen to the expert. It's really going to pay off over time. Commentary on navigating through the corporate politics. Okay. Hi, Sam. Not sure exactly what you mean. I guess at a startup, you would hope that there aren't that many corporate politics yet. And ultimately, you know, marketing is becoming so digital and data-driven, and you can track stuff and you can prove that it's working. So it shouldn't be a political question. You know, you have the data. You can show, okay, someone clicked on social, then visited your website, then downloaded a white paper, then the salesperson spoke to them, and, you know, maybe ideally they became a customer. But even if they don't close, at least you can show the path that they came to you. And that data shows that it's working, and that's how you fill your pipeline and give the sales team something to work with. That's how I've always done it. You know, we had a case where we, you know, in my previous corporate life, where I showed that campaign, you know, we closed a new customer and we did a press release about it. And like the next day, their biggest competitor called us to say, hey, we want to work with you too. And they didn't even know about us before that, but they saw the press coverage, you know, and they knew that we were working with their competitor, and they didn't want the competitor to have a competitive advantage. So it was that direct. So that should hopefully then go above corporate politics. The other comment is just don't get involved. You know, don't get involved in the politics. Stick to the decision maker who's ultimately going to write the check, and then leave the rest to them to navigate. Okay. Any other questions?
Laura, do you want to hop up and ask your question? I saw your hand raised first.
Sure, I'm happy to give Pavel a chance since I already asked one.
Okay, perfect. Let's do that.
Okay. Well, I'm curious. You didn't. I don't believe you touched about this particular point. Are there some particular things about this marketing stages that are particular for climate tech as opposed to general deep tech B2B, or kind of the knowledge that you got from deep tech B2B, it's like you can kind of straightforwardly translate it to climate tech? Are there some things that are more challenging or maybe easier in climate tech or not?
I mean, generally, I think it's actually very transferable. You know, it is a complex C2B sales, so the same rules and complexities apply. The one thing I would say that we see with climate tech is there's sometimes a confusion between the mission of the company and why your customer would buy from you. You know, most of them are mission-driven, and they do it to save the planet. And that's awesome. That's why we're all in this space and why it's so much fun and so rewarding to work here. But it's not why the customer would buy your product. You know, the customer buys because it's cheaper, it's better, it makes them faster, it makes them more productive. So you have to layer your messaging. You know, stick to your vision and your mission for for what you believe in. But when it comes to communicating about the problem you're solving, really stick to what your customer is telling you, what pains they're experiencing. And I think that's often the confusion that we're seeing, that climate tech founders, because they're so proud of what they're doing and they're so passionate about it, you know, they want to talk about, you know, how much more sustainable it will make their customer. Yes, that's usually always a part of the reason why they're buying, but it's usually not the main part. Unless it's a very direct thing, say you're a carbon accounting software company, and then the company really needs to do their carbon accounting because they're under pressure from stakeholders. But even then, it's because they're under pressure from investors or from stakeholders. That's why they need a carbon accounting platform. It's not because they want to be more green, unfortunately. So I think that's one thing that we see. I'm trying to think if I can think of another one. Have you seen anything or experienced anything that you've seen that's particular to climate tech?
Oh, no. I'm working in deep tech. I'm not working in climate tech. Marketing only indirect, but I took part in some marketing campaigns. So yeah, that's why I was curious. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I think deep tech, be it climate tech or not, it's just the long-term game. You know, it just takes time. Same as your product development takes time, and your sales take time, and your marketing takes time. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon, you know. Keep trying to get those touch points with the people you're trying to sell to, and keep, you know, positioning yourself as a thought leader and someone who knows what they're doing and who knows the technology really well. And just build that credibility over time.
Great, thank you so much.
Thank you, Pam. Laura, do you want to go next?
Sure, it's actually kind of related maybe to the earlier question. I'm doing a fellowship through Climate Base, and we're learning about all these different solutions. And one thing I'm seeing a lot of is that they're either working on solutions that are super expensive, right? Like they're hoping that the price will, like, for example, like green hydrogen, like it's really expensive right now, but they're hoping it'll kind of come down over time. Or like they're still lurking to like validate the solution. Like there's a really cool company called Yardstick. It's doing like soil carbon identification on site, but they're like, we still have to make it work. And I'm so curious about, like, especially with these topics like energy and like ag tech, where there's so much like proving the solution, and it's just going to take some extra time to like get that cost down or get the product working. I'm curious like how you think about those in the context of those values, given that they're playing with some different dynamics.
Yeah, you know, and it is tricky. And I think there it's really about finding the right partner for the first pilot. Because, you know, there are ways. You can either try and go through strategic investors who are, you know, the corporate VC arms who are specifically scouting for companies who will help their big corporate, you know, transform or whatever. So those guys might be more likely to take a risk and do a, you know, carve out a pilot and like a sandbox scenario where it doesn't directly impact their operations, but at least give you the space to try it out and prove it. Or you can work with accelerators and incubators where you will get some initial funding, and they might have some facilities, you know, where you can build stuff or run pilots. Or you can get a grant. I mean, obviously grants are a great way for that initial proving the technology. And I think then it goes back to, you know, really communicating about what you've learned, which everyone knows is a journey. No one expects a final product at the first stage. Excuse me. And then, you know, look at the innovation curve and really try and find those early adopters. We see that with clients all the time. We have a lot of clients that sell to utilities, and large utilities are really the most risk averse companies you can think of. You know, they move really slowly, and they there's a very low appetite to work with startups. But there are exceptions. You know, there's a handful of IOUs who are, it is part of their brand to be progressive and to be different and to be first movers. Or they're smaller co-ops or munis, you know, who don't have such regulatory constraints, they're more concerned about the welfare of their community that they're working in. So again, they're more flexible in what they can do. So really try and seek out those few exceptions that are more willing to take risks or to try something new, or where it's part of their brand to be innovative, and then try and get a pilot with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what we've seen. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I promise I would put the tofu link in the chat, which I haven't done yet. So let me just grab that quickly. Before everyone hops off. there you go. And then I think my contact details, Vinita, you want to send out the recording and the presentation to everyone who registered? Yeah, then we can include.
Yes, I can send the recording. Yeah, I'll send a follow-up in the Lulu. Okay. And we have time for like one more question if anyone has a final question that they want to ask, but up to the audience, of course.
Right. Well, I think it's been great, and I really enjoyed the questions from the audience. So thank you, everyone, for joining. Really enjoyed the conversation and hope it was useful. And thank you, Denise, for having me.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks. Bye. Take care, everyone. Have a good day. Thanks, Ryan. Thanks a lot.